Today, we're talking about one of the most intensive programs you can learn in landscape architecture, AutoCAD. Because as I'm sure most of you know by now, that this is an incredibly complex program and there is just an endless amount of knowledge you can gain. I'm still learning things every week and I've been using this for the last 4 or 5 years now. So in an effort to try and simplify this very complex program, I've broken down AutoCAD into some very key fundamental features to understand to hopefully propel your education, your learning, and your speed and workflow using AutoCAD. So grab a snack or follow along with me in CAD during this breakdown and tutorial. Now, the reason why I say features instead of tools with AutoCAD is because if you can understand how the functions work and how CAD likes to operate and how it likes to put out different ideas and output its resources, then you can have a better understanding of the tools. Because all of these features and programs within AutoCAD that I'm gonna talk about can be applied to every single tool that you're using. So by understanding these, it will enhance and improve your understanding of each tool and will allow you to use those tools to its most efficient and maximum potential. So assuming you have a basic sense of what the app looks like when you launch it, the first thing you wanna become very familiar with is the command prompt. This prompt can be found at the bottom of your screen while you are typing out a command or while you're using a command or a tool. And what this does is tells you what your next step is using whatever program, feature, or tool you're using, as well as lets you know what options you have for the next move or what options are possible within that tool. So for example, if we use the polyline tool, the first thing it's gonna want you to do is specify a point. Then after you specify that point, it will tell you what to do next, which is to specify another point or choose from a range of options that it gives you with a bunch of different keybinds. So this happens with every tool. And what's great is that you're not actually leaving the tool to do these things. So within that polyline, for example, you can be using the polyline, create one segment, and then it can either tell you to create another line segment or you can choose from an arc. So this is how you can go back and forth from drawing straight lines to curved lines back to straight. You can all change it within the tool. So you can quickly see how if you didn't understand where this command prompt was or what you can do with it, that you wouldn't be able to take full advantage of this polyline tool and you would think it could simply just do straight lines that either create a box or create some sort of object or line segment. Another thing the command prompt does is it keeps an active log of what you're doing. So as you're going through things and manipulating things and trying new things, you'll be able to see exactly what you did before and how it impacted it. So that way you can see if the function went through, if it didn't go through, or what you did maybe wasn't the option you wanted to choose. So there's always a log there of what you've been doing. So just remember that the command prompt will always be there in case you are lost or and looking for what you're supposed to be doing next within that tool. And it's unique to every tool, every function, every program. So every time you do something in CAD, that command prompt will change and let you know what the next step is for you. The second thing to take into consideration and learn is the Layers Property Manager. Now, this could be an entire video in itself, but to get a good baseline and understanding of it is really gonna go a long way in your drafting ability and your output ability in AutoCAD. Because it's really not an understatement in saying that by understanding the Layers Property Manager as well as possible, will be able to lead you to be able to export and show exactly what you're trying to show in CAD, in PDF, or in any other form medium you're trying to use. This is something I overlooked and underestimated in school, and I really learned a lot more about it when I started working, and it really was a big learning adjustment for me during that time. Because as you know, thickness, line weights, the quality, and all of that are more important than the actual drawing itself. So if you can't represent your ideas, but you can draw perfectly in CAD, then it doesn't matter. So you really need to master this. So to find it, it's located in the Home tab as the Layers Property Manager, or you can just type layer. And then you'll be greeted with this interface with a bunch of different options and layers if you've created some. So take some time to get familiar with what this window looks like, as you're gonna be spending a lot of time here because this is where you're gonna do a lot of tweaking, changing of line weights, changing of colors, adding new layers, manipulating layers, renaming layers, all those things you're gonna be doing here. So just play around and take some time to figure out what does what. As you're going through this, you might notice that there are things that will work separately or work together. So you have a model effect and then you have a layout effect. And this is something you're gonna wanna get familiar with as you're gonna be playing around with these two all the time. Because a lot of times, when we're plotting something, we don't necessarily want to show everything we've been drafting with. So things like non-plot layers or guidelines or things that are meant to help us and guide us while we're drafting, we might not want to show in the final product. So here is where we can toggle and make sure that the guidelines and things that we want to show while drafting are showing, but when they're in the layout, they're not showing and it's automatic and it does it every time. So you just hit print and it automatically does it. That all happens here. And the other feature you'll probably use even more is the colors tabs. Basically in CAD, every color has a certain line weight associated with it. So you wanna get very familiar with what each color means in terms of line weight and which colors generally represent what thing. Some represent pavement, some are curbs, some are plants. You wanna get to know those things, which will happen over time and are unique to a firm. But having a baseline understanding will help your drawings read much better when they're output. So the best way to really do this is to just make a bunch of different layers and all have different line weights, print them out and see what the line weights look like and how they change depending on what color you choose. And then eventually when you're in a firm or have some standards, you'll basically have a list of what to choose from already. But essentially, the more you can practice and the more you can play around with CAD, the more familiar we'll be and the better you'll be suited when you're learning new things or in a new office. Now, in addition to the layers property manager, you wanna get familiar with the properties tab as well. You can find this by just typing properties, and this is essentially your layer management layer or anything you've selected will show up here. So this is incredibly useful for a few different things. By using the properties tab, you can see a bunch of various different information about that line or that segment or that object you've chosen. It will tell you things like the length, the height, the width, the area, the volume if you're working three-dimensionally, where it lives in your coordinate system, where it lives in real world coordinates, where it lives in your plan view. All of those things can be found there and can be manipulated all within that tab. So it's not really something new or hard to learn. It's really just a matter of understanding where to look when you're trying to figure out different things while you're drafting or where you're drawing or putting out different ideas. Now on the flip side, this next feature is very important to landscape architects and is something I honestly did not know enough about until I started working professionally. And that is the user coordinate system, or otherwise known as the UCS. I guess to explain very briefly, it's what your crosshair shows, and it's the map and region of where every point you make, an object, segment, whatever it is, anything you draw in there lives in some sort of coordinate system, and it happens to be based on what your UCS is set as. For us, one of the important things of a UCS and to make sure we're in the right coordinate system is to make sure we're in world UCS, which by default you're in world UCS and you can always check by just typing UCS and then hitting W for world. And this is important to us as landscape architects because we're often working with civil files, we're working with surveys, we're working with architectural drawings, and those things all live in real world coordinates. So they need to make sure they're brought in their real world space, or else problems will happen down the road when we're constructing them. But where UCS can become very effective, in addition to just making sure you're bringing in drawings on the right coordinate system, is you can use it to your advantage to speed up the workflow of many different things. Because as you'll know, most of your sites, your buildings, or anything you want to pull angles off of consistently, orthogonally, however you may want to do it, usually don't fall on the world UCS coordinate system. They're usually offset in some sort of degree. And what's great about UCS is you can actually change the UCS to work for you, to work for either a building, a street, or whatever you might be pulling consistent lines off of. So you'll be able to set up multiple UCSs, and each one can be saved and named, and you can swap between them simultaneously all at the same time. It all works seamlessly and it's saved between each project. And what's great is you can combine it with the plan command, which can change your viewport to match your UCS. So say you have your world UCS which might be at this angle, and then you have your plan or building, which is at a different angle, you can then make the UCS to match and then shift it so that your coordinate system reads 90-90 with your eyes. Now you might be thinking at this point, well, that's great, but how do I bring in all of those different documents correctly? And that's what the XRF manager is for. Now with XRFs, you wanna make sure that you're doing two things before you bring in that new file or document, PDF, DWG, whatever it may be. And that is to first make sure that you are in world coordinate system, and then make sure that you're on layer zero, because we never draw anything on layer zero. So your XRF will never get confused or frozen or tied with some other layer that you're drawing on. Otherwise, it's pretty straightforward when you bring it in. The other major thing you usually think about is whether you want to bring it in as an overlay or an attachment. An attachment basically carries through all other documents. So if you attach something to that and then pull that into something else, it'll carry through, whereas an overlay will only be stamped on with whatever you're bringing that one file in. And the last feature I'll mention today is the blocks in AutoCAD. Now again, blocks is incredibly complex and I still don't know enough about blocks, but if you can have a baseline understanding of it, it's gonna really help your workflow and help you understand how to get the most out of AutoCAD. But basically what a block is it's similar to a component in SketchUp, where it's something that you've created and you want it to be a standard or utilized multiple times without having to recreate it. And that's what a block is. It has a set of properties that are tied to them, attributes, and there's a lot of different things that you can go into with blocks, but that's essentially what it is in a nutshell. And they can be used anywhere. They can be used once they're created in different plans, in different DWGs, anywhere along the line, because they're saved as an actual thing within CAD. So for us, a lot of our blocks are used for creating things like trees or furniture or lighting fixtures or things of that nature. But that's not what it's just limited to. You can also use it for title blocks, callouts, annotative layers. There's tons of options, but they really help you set a standard of drawings and CAD visuals all within your own space. So what makes it so unique? Well, it's great for your speed and your workflow, because you could say draw 50 trees that are 20 feet in diameter, and you find out down the road that you couldn't get a caliper of that size and you need to change the plan to reflect it. So you change it to a 15 foot diameter. And if you change it in the block and you created a block for that, then it will get updated everywhere throughout all of your documents. Whereas if you didn't, if you just drew that, offset them, copy paste it or whatever, then you're gonna have to manipulate all of those one by one throughout all the documents. So it can be incredibly time consuming down the road, and it's just a really nice feature to have in your back pocket. Like I said, that's just the surface. It goes a lot deeper than that, and it deserves probably 3 videos in its own on how to actually use this thing. But that will get you by for now and have you a great basic understanding of how to use them. But now that you have a better understanding of the features and tools within CAD, it will definitely help make the tools you're learning a lot easier to pick up, and it will help you have a better understanding of what you're doing and changing within CAD. So with that said, let me just touch upon what I use most often tool-wise as a landscape architect. Now for drafting, I pretty much use 3 tools. The first one is the polyline tool. This allows you to create a series of line segments or arcs in a sequential pattern that can either be enclosed on each other or just make up a long linear line, like a road, a curb, etc. And this will get most of your baseline. These can always be edited, modified, exploded, grouped, offset, and modified in any way you can think of after the draft is set up. Next one to know about is the hatch tool. Now this will be primarily used for all of your fills and is most commonly used usually to describe maybe a paving pattern or have a tie to a legend or to construction documents, but they really just help paint the picture and help identify what it is you've drawn. And the final 2 drafting tools I usually use is the ellipse or circle. And I like to use those if I'm creating a free form or standing still by itself circle or ellipse. Otherwise, I usually just use polyline, because you can use an arc or different radiuses all within that one tool. After those main drafting tools, I pretty much am either using the modifying tools or doing some sort of a call out or annotation. And that's about it for CAD drawing. And for that, I pretty much use most of the things in the Modify tab except for the Stretch tool. And every Modify tool works very similarly to the polyline. And as you're learning them, you'll see that they give you a couple different options within that command prompt, so it's very easy to pick up and understand. And they're very self-explanatory as well. So my lasting thoughts are, remember that AutoCAD is not a race, and the more you can practice and experiment with the program, the better you will be. And remember that command prompt is your friend and will help you guide through your journey. But on that note, if you have any questions about anything that I talked about in the video, be sure to drop a comment below. And if you're interested in me making this into a mini series about AutoCAD and getting into the weeds a little bit more, let me know. And of course, if you found this video helpful, be sure to give this a thumbs up and share it with a friend who is learning AutoCAD. Also, if you're new here or not currently subscribed, but you're interested in landscape architecture, my whole channel is dedicated to teaching landscape architecture, so be sure to check it out. But that's all for me today, so thank you for listening. I hope you learned some new things, and I will see you in the next video. Peace.